لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لبيك. لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله، الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وآله وصحبه ومن والاه. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا، وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا. The Hajj is the one of the pillars of Islam, أحد أركان الإسلام. And although many Muslims do their best to do the Hajj and they spend wealth and they leave the family behind, but we have noticed, according to our experience, there are many mistakes take place in the Hajj because of the lack of the knowledge. And many Muslims, they just want to go Hajj. They don't have enough time to sit down and learn. And there are some issues in the Hajj, or many issues in the Hajj, do not nullify the Hajj. Hajj is still acceptable, but it will not be Hajj Mabrur. It will reduce the reward of the Hajj, and you might come back with a small reward, not the reward you're supposed to come back with. The beginning of the Hajj is, you know, Hadith Jabir, it's narrated by Jabir and it's reported in Sahih Muslim. This is one of the best hadith that described the Hajj of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, as Jabir described the Hajj of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam from the beginning until the end. What he said during this hadith, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, خذوا أو لتأخذوا عني مناسككم لعلي لا ألقاكم بعد عامي هذا. Learn your rituals or أحكام rules of the Hajj by seeing me, by copying me, by following me, for I don't know whether I would be performing Hajj for after this Hajj of mine or not. The question is, how many times did the Prophet عليه السلام do Hajj? Anyone knows? How many times the Prophet عليه السلام did Hajj? Huh? Once. The answer is not correct, because he did once after the Hijrah. You have to be specific. He did once, he did one Hajj after the Hijrah. But before the Hijrah, he did many. We don't know exactly when. When the Hadith is Sahih Bukhari Muslim, where Jubayr ibn Mut'am said, you know Al-Humus. Al-Humus is Quraysh, the tribe of Quraysh and around Quraysh. They used to believe they are better than the rest of the people, because they say we are the people of the Haram. They say we are people of the Haram, which is true. They were the people of the Haram, but they were mushriks. It doesn't matter you are from the people of the Haram or if you are of the bring of the Prophet alayhi salam. It doesn't matter if you are not upon the right path, if you are not upon the Tawheed, then there is no point, it doesn't benefit you whether from the offspring of Abu Jahl or from the offspring of the Prophet alayhi salam. Because if you are not upon the Tawheed, this will not benefit you. So they used to say, we are the people of the Haram. And what they, because of this, they say, we will not, in the Hajj, we will not come out from the Haram borders. So you know that the Kaaba and the Masjid around the Kaaba is inside the Haram borders. Mina is inside the Haram borders. Muzdalifa is inside the Haram borders. Arafat, it's outside of the Haram borders. And the Arafat is one of the pillars of the Hajj. Those ignorant people at the time of the Jahiliyyah, those Al-Humus, used to say, no, because we are of the people of the Haram, we will not leave Muzdalifah, we'll stay in Muzdalifah. All the Hujjaj go to Arafah except Al-Humus. The Prophet ﷺ, Muhammad, even before the Islam, Allah guided him. He used to go to Arafah. So Jubayr ibn Mut'am saw him in Arafah. He said, Subhanallah, this man is from the Humus. What is he doing here? As if it's something strange. He's supposed not to leave the Haram according to their Jahiliyyah. So the Prophet ﷺ did one Hajjah after the Hijrah. And he showed the companions what to do. And that's why when you go to the Hajj, you need to learn what is compulsory, what is pillar, what is preferable. But always try not to ask, try to do. Whatever that you hear the Prophet ﷺ did it, you try to do it, as this is what the companion used to do, and this is what the Prophet ﷺ told us to do. Start with the mawaqit. Mawaqit, we have mawaqit zamaniya, time of the Hajj, and we have mawaqit makaniya, zone where we have to enter the state of the ihram. Mawaqit zamaniya, it's the time where that we can do the Hajj, we start the Hajj, which is Shawwal and Dhul Qa'da and Dhul Hijjah. And you know that the Hajj will be in the beginning of the Hijjah. But what do we mention Shawwal and Dhul Qa'da? Because one of the type of the Hajj is tamattu'. Tamattu' is that you do the Umrah, then you come out from the state of the Ihram, on the 8th of the Hijjah, you enter the state of the Ihram to start your Hajj. The Umrah should be done during the Hajj months, which is Shawwal or Dhul Qa'da or beginning of the Hijjah. If someone does the Umrah in Ramadan, we will not consider him as a mutamatti' because he didn't do it during the time of the Hajj. And the mawqit, everybody knows, and I don't think I will go in details about these mawqit because usually there are not a lot of things to do. I mean, Dhul Hulayfa is the miqat of Ahl al-Madinah and those who come from the side of Medina, and the Al-Juhfa is for the Syrians and for the people come from that side, UK people as well, when they come by the plane, they pass by the Al-Juhfa. And also Najd, Qarn al-Manazil is for Najd, which is Riyadh, and at that area, Yalamlam is for people from Yemen, and Dhatu Irq for people of Iraq. Now there is a common thing happen during the Hajj days. Someone will go to the Hajj, but his group will go to Jeddah, and from Jeddah will go Medina, not Mecca. To go to Medina, stay in Medina 4 or 5 days, whatever, then come back to Mecca. Now, when you come by the plane, you will pass by Miqat Al-Juhfa, which is your Miqat. We people from UK, we supposed to come from Al-Juhfa, not from Dhul Hulayfa, not Dhul Hulayfa. But because you stop in Jeddah and you go to Medina, you will leave your Miqat and come from Dhul Hulayfa. Do you have to enter the state of the Ihram when you pass by Al-Juhfa, although you're going Medina, or you leave it until you go Medina, spend 4, 5, 6 days, then you come from there? Don't answer, because I know you will say, no, I go Medina, stay in Medina 4 or 5 days, whatever. Then from Medina, you come, pass by Dhul Hulayfa, and you enter the state of the Ihram. This is one of the opinions, because there are different opinions. And inshallah, this is strong opinion and you can rely on it. But just for you, for the sake of knowledge, you have to know that many scholars said, if you pass by your miqat, you have to enter the state of the ihram. Even if you go Medina, which is difficult nowadays. And the fatwa of Sheikh ibn Athaymeen and other scholars, you just need to delay your ihram until you go to Medina, then to the second miqat. Then you can do your ihram there. And there is two things. There is entering the state of the Ihram, the intention of entering the state of Ihram, and the intention of Ihram, which means, now if you are planning to go Hajj this year, have you started your Ihram? No, not yet. You have the intention to go for the Ihram and to do the Hajj, but this is not the intention we're talking about. We're talking about the intention of entering the state of the Ihram. This is where you have to apply what is compulsory upon the Muhrim. And entering the state of the Ihram must be on the Miqat zone. And if you have doubt in the plane, you can do it even before that, as it's permissible to do it even half an hour before the Miqat zone. And usually we tell the people to be in safe side. And when you are on the plane, the pilot might forget to tell you when to enter the state of the Ihram. Just do it when you are in safe side. Usually it's about 20 minutes, half an hour before arriving. So do it as early as possible as to make sure that you are doing it before you pass by the Ihram or Miqat zone. Now, before Ihram, if you are doing your Ihram in Dhul Hulayfa, for example, it's better to do those things to prepare yourself, having a shower, preparing yourself by shaving your mustache, applying perfume in your body, not in your ihram clothes, and praying two rak'ah before entering the state of ihram is not preferable except in Dhul Hulayfa. If you are doing the Umrah or the Hajj from Dhul Hulayfa, it's preferable to do two rak'ah before entering the state of ihram if you are not praying the fard. But if you are praying the fard, then you start your ihram after the fard. The rest of the mawaqit, there is no sunnah, there is no two rak'ah to pray according to the correct opinion. Why we said Dhul Hulayfa is exception? Because Jibreel came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, Salli fi hadha al-wad al-mubarak, pray two rak'ah in this blessed valley. It was a valley in those days. So he commanded him to pray two rak'ah specifically in that miqat zone, which is Dhul Hulayfa. The rest of the mawqit, we didn't have any narration stated that the Prophet ﷺ used to pray two rak'ah before entering the state of ihram. But if you can start your ihram after praying fard, this will be good, and inshallah it will be according to the sunnah. It's permissible during the state of the ihram to have a shower after entering the state of the ihram. Some people think that they cannot have a shower. No, you still can have a ghusl as long as you don't cover your head and you don't do anything, any prohibitions of the ihram, which we will talk about soon inshallah. Don't apply any perfume, either original perfume or perfume that oily perfume or soap that this have perfume or shampoo or perfume shampoo or perfume powder, any kind of these things, which is we can't say it's haram. The haram is the real perfume. This is haram. What we mentioned now, perfume shampoo, it's not a perfume. Even the people do not consider it perfume, but to be in safe side, do not use it. There are sample one which is not perfumed. You can use them during the state of the ihram. You can change your ihram, buying a new one, or you can wash your ihram. That's fine. Using toothpaste is permissible, but it's better to avoid it. Same with the mouthwash. What about eating things that has nice perfume? Like, for example, mint. Tea with mint. You like tea with mint, I think. So drinking tea or mint for the muhram, is it permissible? This is not perfume. This is not perfume. People do not consider perfume, nor it is perfume. So it's permissible. What about saffron, za'faran? People eat za'faran. Do you eat za'faran, saffron? Do you eat saffron? Do you eat it or not? Some people put it in tea. People put it in tea. Eating saffron for the muhram is not permissible. He can't eat it. Because saffron specifically is mentioned in the hadith. And it happens. People give you tea with saffron. Make sure you don't eat it. Unless if it disappeared. Maliki said if the saffron is cooked, then you can use it. But to be in safe side, do not use it while you are in the state of the ihram. Unless if it's completely disappeared. You put it in the tea and you cook it. And then there is no smell, no taste. Then there is no saffron. I mean, you can use it. Prohibitions of the ihram. There are issues that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned while we are in the state of the ihram. We have to avoid them. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned them in one hadith, and the scholars made qiyas, and they tried to understand the wisdom or the reason for that prohibition, and they tried to use the same rule, same hukm, for the rest of the issues that are not mentioned in the hadith. Number one, for example, regular clothes for men. The man cannot wear regular clothes. He can only use the izar, the ihram, which is two pieces of clothes. He can use them for the ihram. There are some exceptions, but these exceptions only in the state of the necessity. For example, wearing underwear, if there is a reason for that. Some people, like the time of the Prophet ﷺ, after that, Aisha, she used to have some people serving her, some boys serving her. So they used to take her luggage and put it on the camel. So when they used to do that, their awra used to be uncovered when they do this, because they need to jump on the camel, come down. So Aisha told them to wear underwear. It's authentic narration. So because of this, the scholars say when there is a necessity, you can put some clothes. But do you have to pay fidya? Yes. You have to pay a fidya, which is to feed 6 people, or to slaughter a sheep, or to fast 3 days. Choose one of them. This is, when you do commit a prohibition, one of the prohibitions of the haram, you can choose one of three things. You feed six people, sa', which is two handfuls of rice or whatever, or you buy food for them, normal food that people eat in that country, and you give, feed six people, or you slaughter a sheep and give it to the poor people in Mecca there, or you fast 3 days. Regular clothes for women is fine. She can wear anything. The women can wear anything except gloves and niqab. That the specific clothes that she tied from the beginning, which is just it's stitched, makhit, according to her face. This is not permissible for the women. The rest she can wear. And the man cannot cover his head. No hat, no caps, no clothes. Umbrella, car roof, that's fine. Because you will see if you go to the Hajj, some groups like Shia, for example, they do not go under anything. Even their car roof, they don't go under the car roof, saying that when you are in the state of the Hajj, do not go under anything. Is this correct? It's preferable, not compulsory. It's preferable to go out and do not go under anything. Not all the time, but this is what the companion used to do. They say, أضحي لمن أحرمت له, which means that don't go under anything when you are in the state of the ihram, unless if there is a need, very hot weather, or you want to sleep, or something like this. But it is not compulsory. You still can use the go inside the car, or go inside the tent, or inside the house, and this will not affect your hajj. Applying perfume before the state of entering the state of ihram is preferable on the body, not in the clothes. But during the state of the ihram, no one is allowed to use perfume, nor in his body, neither in his body nor in his clothes. Cutting the hair or the beard or mustache or shaving armpits or pubic hair, at anything like this you cannot do during the state of the ihram. Although cutting the nails, I mentioned this, you cannot do this. Sexual intercourse with the wife or even foreplay, you cannot do this during the state of the ihram, and this is the worst thing you can do during the state of the ihram. Sexual intercourse before at-tahallul al-awwal, before ending Arafah, this will nullify the hajj. This will nullify. This is the only prohibition will nullify the hajj. And also proposal of marriage, it's not permissible. Hunting, which I don't think any one of us will hunt there. I don't think you'll find anything to hunt there anyway. But hunting is not permissible during the state of the ihram and inside the haram. When the person wants to start his hajj, he has to start, or before entering the state of the ihram, he has to start saying tasbih and takbir and istighfar and tahleel. It's mentioned Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet ﷺ before said labbaik Allahumma hajjan or labbaik Allahumma amra, he said saying subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Then he said labbaik Allahumma hajjan or labbaik Allahumma umrah, la riya'a fiha wa la sum'a. When you say this, you are not pronouncing the intention. You are saying the nusuk. You are specifying your nusuk, and the intention is in your heart. The intention is in your heart. And then you start the talbiyah, which is labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika lak. Talbiyah is the main thing in the hajj. I mean, the talbiyah is the main meaning you learn in the hajj. Talbiyah is tawheed, is to oneness Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are saying that I am doing the hajj for the sake of Allah. You are saying that I am submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all the important meanings you need, you are saying it in the talbiyah. لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك. So you are practicing the tawheed. You are saying the tawheed. That's why Jabir, when he talked about the talbiyah, he said ولبى بالتوحيد. The Prophet ﷺ raised his voice with saying the tawheed. So he called the talbiyah tawheed, which means the talbiyah, the meaning of the talbiyah, the real meaning of the talbiyah is to oneness Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's a dhikr that the hajji or the mu'tamar must keep saying it, as it is the most important dhikr to say during the hajj. And the man should say loudly, as loud as possible, And a woman can say it loudly when there is no foreigners, otherwise she has to say it silently. The time, when do we start the talbiyah? For the haji, he starts the talbiyah when he enters the state of the ihram. When does he need to stop the talbiyah? During the umrah, there are two opinions. One opinion, the opinion of Ibn Abbas, talbiyah should be stopped when the person start his umrah, start his tawaf, facing the Hajar al-Aswad, the black stone. An opinion of Ibn Umar, when you enter the borders of the Ahram, you stop saying the talbiyah, and this is the closest opinion to the truth. As it's based on a hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, Ibn Umar described what he did that, then he said this is what the Prophet ﷺ did. So when you enter the borders of the Haram, you stop the talbiyah if you are doing the Umrah. On the Hajj, you stop doing the talbiyah when you start stoning on the day of Eid. So you start the talbiyah on the 8th of the Hijjah when you enter the state of the Ihram. And when you start stoning on the day of Eid, you stop the talbiyah. So in the Umrah, you stop it when you enter the border of the Haram. And in the Hajj, you stop it when you start stoning. Tawaf al-Qudum, which is the tawaf when you arrive to the Mecca, whether you are doing Umrah or you're doing Hajj Ifrad or you're doing Hajj Qiran, we will talk about this later. But it's a ibadah, tawaf is a ibadah. And we have only one place we can make tawaf there, which is in Kaaba. Because some people do tawaf where? In graveyards, for example. They go to graveyards and they do tawaf 7 times. Is this permissible? No. Why is not permissible? Because tawaf is a ibadah, is a worship. And when there is a worship, you cannot do it according to your understanding. You have to do it according to the Quran and the Sunnah. And now we don't have any narrations that the Prophet ﷺ nor the companions did tawaf except in the around the Kaaba. Tawaf, when you do tawaf, you have to have wudu. You have to have the wudu. And you have to make sure you cover your awra. And you have to do it 7 times. It must be 7 times. And it starts from the black stone, end with the black stone. Kaaba must be left on the left-hand side. Why do we mention this? Because some people, for example, during the tawaf, he remembers something, he just turned back and started making, reversing now. So where's the Kaaba now? It will be in the right-hand side, which is wrong. He has to go back and just do it, start from where he started that reversing and make sure the Kaaba is on the left-hand side. And should be around the Kaaba. You see the Hijr, the small wall, just next to the Kaaba, they call it Al-Hijr. People call it Hijr Ismail, and this is just people calling it. There is no Ismail on that time anyway. I mean, it happens before the time, after the time of Ismail. Because you know when the Mushriks saw the Kaaba is very old and they wanted to rebuild the Kaaba, they demolished the Kaaba. And they start rebuilding it. And they said, make sure you don't put 1 dinar from haram resources. And one of the main 2 haram resources at the time of the Mushriks, Jahileen, ignorant people at that time was zina and riba, fornication and interest, riba. Those were the main 2 haram resources on those time. So what happened? They said, Jazakallah khair. They said, do not put any money in the Kaaba, i.e. buying the bricks or whatever used in the Kaaba. Do not use any haram money. But in those days, most of their money were haram. So what happened, like nowadays, isn't it? Most of our money now is riba. Most of the, even the Muslims, a lot of their monies is haram. Maybe you doubt it. You know, one of the previous statistics, we have those big companies, shareholders. We have 3 types. One is 100% haram company. Like, for example, company dealing with pornography or pigs, selling alcohol, 100% haram, dealing completely with haram. And 100% halal company, no interest, nothing. It's halal, straightforward. And mixed company, it's halal, but either they put their money in haram, interest. So what do you think about the percentage? Can you give me a rough idea? What do you think about the percentage? What's the percentage of the haram company? Just try it. There is no reward, no punishment, nothing, akhi. Huh? 80%, 100%? No. I'm talking about haram, clear haram companies, 19%. And pure halal companies, what do you think? 1%. Mixed company, 80%. So you see the difference? Most of the money is mixed haram with halal. As I'm telling you, maybe you say, oh, he's exaggerating. Oh, what is he saying? We are Abu Jahl. No, but our money now is, most of our money is from haram sources. Not me and you specifically. Talk about, generally speaking, people just, the akhi is difficult to control your money completely away from the haram resources now. So anyway, so they said, do not put 1 dinar from haram resources. So because of that, they didn't have enough money to rebuild the Kaaba completely at the same place like Ibrahim did. So what happened? They just built it as you see it now. And you see that small wall. They put that small wall to say that this is from the Kaaba, but we didn't have enough money to complete it. So this place, this small wall, indicates to the, this part is from the Kaaba. And that's when you pray in that part as if you're praying in the Kaaba. So when you make tawaf, do not enter inside that place. You have to do tawaf after that place, after the hijr, to count it as a tawaf. And when you talk about these things, it might be not very essential for you. But you know, some small mistakes like this will give you hard time. If your wife, for example, do a small mistake, does not complete the tawaf, she's tired, 6 tawaf, she said, I'm tired now, finish, just leave one, go pray to rak'ah, or maybe for any reason, do tawaf not properly, then come back, especially tawaf al-ifada. Scholars will tell you, you're still in state of, you're still in hajj. You have to go back and do tawaf. You are in UK, you have to go back. So you might be in trouble if you don't do it properly. If you don't start from the beginning, if you don't start from the beginning, for example, if the salah, adhan is given and the salah is about to start and you're doing tawaf, what shall you do? Shall you start from where you stopped or shall you repeat the whole tawaf? There's different opinion. Inshallah, the closest opinion to the truth is you just start from where you stopped. As long as it's a short cut, short time, not long time. Don't go relax, sleep in the hotel, come back 10 o'clock p.m. You start at 10 o'clock a.m., come back 10 p.m. and say, I complete my tawaf. This long delay, you can't do this. Okay, sunnah of tawaf, kissing black stone, which is difficult to do now. If you can do, alhamdulillah. For sisters, forget it. As simple as this, forget it. Don't think about it. Because before she kisses the black stone, which is preferable, she will commit major sins, which is logically wrong, Islamically wrong. And if not, then if you can't touch the black stone by your hand and kiss your hand. If not, even if I have a stick, umbrella, whatever, you can touch it and you kiss that thinging, that's fine. If not, do what most of the people do. Just face the black stone, by your body, and raise your hand, say, Allahu Akbar. This is the way how you started. You do attiba' and tawaf al-qudum, attiba' uncovering the right shoulder. You just start it before tawaf, not in the plane. Some people in Heathrow here, they uncover their right shoulder. This is wrong. You start there when you are in front of the black stone. There's something called ramal. Ramal is jogging, walking. It's like the scholars, when they describe the ramal, said to move your shoulder and to walk very short steps, but fast. This is the way of describing ramal. And you do this in the first three rounds of tawaf al-qudum. It's only in tawaf al-qudum, when you arrive. In tawaf al-ifada and day of Eid, you don't do this. You don't do neither uncovering your shoulder nor ramal, as this is not from the sunnah. When you arrive to the, now when we said black stone, you start from black stone, the second corner, third corner, fourth corner called al-rukn al-yamani. It's from the sunnah to wipe al-rukn al-yamani if you can. No waving, no kissing, just wipe if you can. It's from the sunnah, otherwise don't do anything. From the rukn al-yamani to the black stone, it's from the sunnah to say, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَبَ النَّارِ. The rest of the tawaf or the rest positions of tawaf, you can say anything. Dua, istighfar, anything. There is no specific dua to do except in that area. And this meaning of dua, Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar, will cover all your needs. You do not need more than anything, more than this. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhab an-nar. If Allah accepts this dua from you, that's enough. You don't need anything else. Drinking Zamzam after finishing the tawaf and after the ramal and in covering the right shoulder is just for the male, not female. And if the ramal will cause you to lose your mahram, then you stay with your mahram as it's sunnah, not compulsory. Sunnah, not compulsory to do ramal. When the person finishes the tawaf, the 7 rounds, he should go behind Maqam Ibrahim, that golden place where Ibrahim used to stand up and build the Kaaba, alayhi salatu wasalam. So if you can pray behind that place, will be sunnah. If not, you can pray any place in the haram. If not, you can pray it even outside the haram. So let's say, for example, you're doing a preferable tawaf. You finish, and you leave the haram, you pray the 2 rak'ah outside the haram. As long as you're inside the borders of the haram, it's fine. That's fine. I'm saying this because you might find it difficult to pray behind Maqam Ibrahim. So 2 rak'ah there, and when you're heading towards Maqam Ibrahim, read the verse that وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَهِيمَ مُصَلَّى, and pray 2 rak'ah, reciting in the first rak'ah Al-Fatiha, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ, and in the second rak'ah Al-Fatiha, and قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. This is when you finish this, go and drink Zamzam. Go and drink Zamzam. To be honest with you, the hadith that talked about drinking Zamzam said that the Prophet ﷺ drank Zamzam after Tawaf Al-Ifada. On the day of Eid, when he came back to Mecca and he do the Tawaf, he drank Zamzam on that time. But the scholars say after Tawaf Al-Qudum, you can drink Zamzam as well, and drink Zamzam as much as you can. As much as you can. This is just, maybe you've seen this, so I don't think you need to learn about it. These are just to tell you some... I hope, inshallah, I don't tawaf like this. It's packed. But it shows you what to, where, I mean, for example, here, so this is the hijr we talked about, that where that small wall, where you, behind it is the, it's considered a part of the Kaaba. You can't do tawaf inside, crossing inside the hijr. Arukn al-Yamani is on the right-hand side. Maqam Ibrahim is there. And here the door of the Kaaba and the Hajj al-Aswad. You know, you see the small part between the door of the Kaaba and Hajj al-Aswad? This is called Al-Multazam. Al-Multazam. You see that? Small place. Al-Multazam is from the Sunnah, if you can, to go there and just do this by putting your face and hands just as if you hug it. And you make dua there. It's the Prophet ﷺ did so. It will be difficult. It will be difficult during the Hajj. But if you can do, that will be good and sunnah. The green light to show you the beginning of tawaf, make sure you don't stop. Just go and say, face the black stone, say Allah Akbar and go. Stopping there cause delay and cause problems for the people behind you. When you finish, before you go sa'i, come back to the black stone and face it and say Allahu Akbar. Now we said every round you pass by black stone, you say Allahu Akbar and face it. In the 7th round, don't do it. In the 7th round, when you finish, don't do it. You just at the beginning. When you finish, don't do it. But when you go and pray to rak'ah, drink Zamzam, come back and do it. Say Allahu Akbar. And go as-sa'i. When you're heading towards al-mas'a, you recite Inna Safa wal Marwa min Sha'air Allah. And you know the story of the mas'a, how was Hajar running between the Safa and Marwa to find water for her baby Ismail. Everybody knows this. And a sa'i is a pillar in Umrah and a pillar in the Hajj, according to the correct opinion. There are different opinions, but it's a pillar. It's one of the pillars of the Hajj. The pillars of the Umrah, Ihram, Tawaf, Sa'i, and Halq, or shaving. In the Hajj, Ihram, Tawaf al-Wada, Tawaf al-Ifada, and Sa'i, which is pillar as well. So what you need to do before sa'i? Sa'i, as we mentioned, should be after tawaf. Should it be straight away after tawaf? This is the sunnah. Sunnah to do it straight away. But if there is any reason and you cannot do it straight away after tawaf, you become tired, your mahram is tired, you want to relax even for half an hour, 1 hour, you can do so. But the sunnah to do it straight away. Beginning of the masai is on As-Safa, that small mountain. You face the Qibla, you raise your hands, you say that dua, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير لا إله إلا الله وحده أنجز وعده ونصر عبده وهزم الأحزاب وحده. Then you make a long dua, then you repeat this dhikr, make a long dua, then you repeat it, then you start heading towards Al-Marwa. By that time your right shoulder should be uncovered. And in tawaf, majority of the scholars say tahara is compulsory. Tahara is compulsory. But in sa'i, tahara is not compulsory, agreed upon. So if you break your wudu, for example, or the women finish the tawaf, then she involved in state of the menstruating period, then there is no harm to complete the sa'i. And when you're heading towards the Al-Marwa, you make any dua you wanted to do. You see those green lights, when you reach the green lights, you have to run. For the men, you have to run until you reach the second green light. It's from the sunnah to do so. And there is no specific dua, as I said, from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Types of hajj. Hajj, we have three types. One called ifrad, which many people do not do who come from abroad. Most of the people do ifrad, they come from, they are living there. But it's permissible if you want to do ifrad, you do it. You say, labbaik Allahumma hajjan. And when you enter the state of the ihram, when you say, labbaik Allahumma hajjan, you just do the tawaf al-qudum. And if you want to do sa'i, you can do sa'i. But you don't repeat it again. It's one sa'i. And you don't come out from the state of ihram. Hajj ifrad, you do only hajj. There is no umrah with it. And you do only one sa'i. And you don't come out from the state of the ihram. And there is no compulsory hadi. Preferable, of course. It's preferable to slaughter as much as you can. But it's not compulsory upon you to do hadi. So this is ifrad. Umar used to do ifrad a lot. Radiallahu anhu ardah. Qiran is to combine hajj and umrah. Labbaik Allahumma umratan wa hajjan. So when you do that, you go and you do the tawaf al-qudum as well. And if you want to do sa'i, you can do sa'i. And this sa'i, if you do it, will be enough for you, as one sa'i is compulsory upon you. You do not need to repeat another sa'i on the day of Eid. So the hajj mufrid and al-qarin, they need to do one sa'i, not two sa'i. And here, in this situation, in Qiran, it's preferable to have your hadi with you before the miqat. Before the miqat. Preferable, not compulsory, according to the majority of the scholar. And the same, when you finish the tawaf and sa'i in the Qiran, like mufrid, you stay in your state of the ihram. Even for 1 month, you stay in the state of ihram. And the correct opinion, inshallah, the Prophet ﷺ did hajj Qiran, not tamattu, nor ifrad. And you know, when did the Prophet ﷺ leave Medina? He left Medina on the 25th of Dhul Qa'dah. And he arrived to Mecca on 4th of the Hijjah. How many days? 9 days on camels. Just from Medina to Mecca, which is about 400 kilometers, isn't it? Now we go from UK to there, 6 hours for maybe, how many, 4,000 kilos? 5,000 kilos. And we arrive there very tired and complaining, delay, headache. Although you're sitting maybe in the first class, eating, drinking, subhanAllah, the people, I mean, we are weaker than them, radiallahu anhum, wa ardahum. But there are some people that are very, very strong until this moment. One of the shuyukh in Mecca is a very close friend to me, Sheikh Abu Bakr al-Baydani. He was living in Hail. He moved to Mecca. He was telling me himself. He said, the reason that I moved to Mecca was one of the hajj, one of the times he was doing hajj, he said, I met a Pakistani man from Pakistan. And I was talking to him. He was poor. He would just try to find any job to do, helping you, taking your luggage to get some money to spend. No, sorry, I mixed two things. This helping people is Afghani brother. Pakistani person did Hajj. He met that brother, that Sheikh Abu Bakr. Sheikh Abu Bakr was talking to him. He said, how was the Hajj? He said, Alhamdulillah, fine, etc. So he said, how did you come here? He said to him, I had a house in Pakistan. He divided the house, sold half of the house to get the expenses of the Hajj to come to Mecca. So Sheikh Abu Bakr said, subhanAllah, this man sold half of his house to come. And me, I'm just in Hail. So he left Hail, he came and stayed in Mecca. Now, maybe 10 years now, he's in Mecca. May Allah give him barakah and carry on there until he dies, inshallah. So people still spend a lot to come to that place. Alhamdulillah, Allah bless us with wealth and health and easy life. So we have to thank Allah for this. And we have to appreciate this by doing Umrah at least as much as we can if you cannot do Hajj. This is the Quran. Tamattu' is when you enter the state of Ihram, say labbaik Allahumma Umrah. You do Umrah, which most of the people do now. And when you arrive to Mecca, you do Tawaf al-Qudum, you do Sa'i, and then you shave, you cut, and you come completely out of the state of the Ihram. And on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, you enter the state of the Ihram. What's the difference? You must do two sa'i. On the day of Eid, when you do tawaf al-ifada, you have to do sa'i again. Not like the mufrid and qarin. Not like the mufrid and qarin. And this hajj is easier for most of the people who come from abroad. It's easier for them. That's, we mentioned that the hadi is compulsory on mutamatti' and qarin. Hajj, the one who did hajj mufrid, only Hajj, no Umrah, is not compulsory upon him to do the Hadi. It's preferable only. 8th of Dhul Hijjah, Yawm al-Tarwiyah. Tarwiyah, watering the camels and the horses and what they used to use as vehicles on those days. Now maybe putting petrol. Anyway, so watering, they call it Yawm al-Tarwiyah. Just good. Tarwiyah is from drinking water, al-Ray. So they used to water the camels on those days. On those days in Tarwiyah, so they can start their trip towards Mina and Muzdalifah and Arafat. And it's the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, it's preferable to go Mina on that day and spend the whole day in Mina praying Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr, shortening Dhuhr and Asr and Isha, and do not combine, just pray and increase your talbiyah. Obviously, you have to do the, if you are mutamatti', you enter the state of the Ihram while you are in your accommodation in Mecca, wherever you are. And for the Qarin and Mufrid, he's already in the state of the Ihram, he just need to go there. It's Sunnah, not compulsory to be in Mina on that day, and as we said, it's preferable. Yom Arafah, day of Arafah, is 9th of Arafah. This is the most important day, and this day, day of Arafah, is pillar, and every Hajji must make sure he goes to Arafah on that day, as missing that day or missing Arafah means that no Hajj. And we have to leave Mina after sun rises, go to Arafah, stay in Arafah, nothing to do until you pray Dhuhr and Asr, combining and shortening. After that, then everyone should focus in dua. Before that, you can talk, you can laugh. It's a narrated that Ibn Umar, it's authentic narration. Ibn Umar, when they start leaving Mina to Arafat, just to show you how Islam is easy. You know, some people make it complicated. Sometimes if you talk Allah, you say, come on, calm down, you are Hajj. You know, this is not the way of the Hajj of the companion used to know when they focus in dua, and they used to know when they relax. So when he was leaving from Mina to Arafat, the narrator said the closest person to Ibn Umar was a funny guy. Someone was very funny and just makes Ibn Umar laugh. Umar was walking with him and laughing until they reached Arafat. When he prayed Dhuhr and Asr, finish. Now he's focusing dua, stopped laughing and concentrating or reciting Quran or dhikr, whatever. So sometimes you need to relax so you can prepare yourself. You can prepare yourself. We advise the brothers sometimes don't go to pray in the Masjid Namira, as it's difficult and will make you tired. They don't listen. They go and they come back sleeping at the Maghrib. So they miss the most important time of dua by going there. So you have to use your mind. What is the most important thing? To do dua and seek Allah's forgiveness and say, La ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, lahul mulku wa lahul hamdu wa ala kulli shayin qadir. This is the most important thing. And the day of Arafah, do not leave Arafah until sun sets. And this, to be in safe side, do so, because although it is the correct opinion that as long as you stay in Arafah, whether during the day or night, this will be enough. But according to the Maliki, for example, you must stay in the night and the day and part of the night. Otherwise, your Hajj will be in a big question mark. This is not the strongest opinion, but always be in safe side. Do what the Prophet ﷺ did. Stay in Arafah until sunsets. As soon as the sun sets, you can leave Arafah and go to Muzdalifah. Going Muzdalifah, when you arrive in Muzdalifah, you pray in Maghrib and Isha by making one adhan and two iqama and combining the salah and shorting the Isha. After that, there is no specific dua. The Prophet ﷺ just slept, which means that it doesn't mean that he didn't pray witr. If you pray witr, you pray witr on that day. But Jabir said he didn't do anything. He slept. He said he slept. This is what according to the Jabir narrations. But if you look at the other narrations, that the Prophet ﷺ on that night prepared the weak people from his family and some women like Sauda and sent them all these things that done on that night, and Jabir did not mention that. Which means that the person does not do any specific dua or qiyamul layl, etc. But he just need to relax. You can pray your witr and relax, and then you have to leave Muzdalifah either with the da'afa, weak people, or with the strong people. We have two types of people on that day. When we say weak people, it doesn't mean that only disabled. No. Disabled women, they can leave early because women usually are weak. Children, so they can leave when the moon disappears. This is the best sign to understand the time of leaving Muzdalifah. When the moon disappears, leave Mina, which is about 2 o'clock, you leave Muzdalifah. And this is according to the narration of Asma in Sahih al-Bukhari. So when the moon disappears, leave Muzdalifah. The weak people should leave Muzdalifah. If you are a mahram for a weak woman, you can go with her. You can go with her as she needs you with her. But if you are alone, then it's sunnah and you have to stay, actually. You have to stay until Fajr. You pray Fajr. Then you make dua after Fajr and leave before sun rises. For both, those who are making ta'ajjil, leaving early, and those who are leaving after Fajr, both should stay to make dua for a while. Making dua and istighfar and dhikr, tasbih. Then they leave Mina. For the muta'ajjilun, they leave Mina after, as I said, moon disappears. And for those who are not making ta'ajjil before, they have to make sure that they leave Muzdalifah before sunsets. As the jahiliyyah, the ignorance people, the people of shirk, used to leave Muzdalifah after the sun rises. We have to do it before that. Picking up the stones is not compulsory to do in Muzdalifah. Actually, the Prophet ﷺ did it in Mina, but now you cannot find it in Mina. So if you do it from Muzdalifah, it's fine. If you pick it up from Arafat, it's fine. If you want to pick it up in Mecca, it's fine. As long as you have stones with you to do the compulsory stoning on that day. You see the traffic here? So you can imagine how long it's going to take from you to finish this. And this is what the scholars call barakah in your time. Allah bless you in your time to finish all the a'mal, the actions supposed to be done on the day of Eid. You see, imagine that with me. Now, of course, the number of the people now is larger than the time of the Prophet ﷺ. On the time of the Prophet ﷺ, there were maybe 140, around 1,000. Now 2-3 millions. But even the facilities now is different. It's better facilities now. But you still think about this. The Prophet ﷺ is using a camel. He left Muzdalifah before sunsets, and he arrived to Jamarat, and he gave a talk. And he stoned the Jamarat 7 times, gave a talk. And he slaughtered 63 camels, exactly like his age, 63 years old. 63 camels, and gave the rest to Ali. 100 camels, he brought with him 100 camels, alayhi salatu salam. Ali slaughtered the rest. And then the Prophet ﷺ had a shower, changing clothes, after finishing the slaughtering and eating, eating from these 100 camels, small beasts from each one. After finishing this, he went to Mecca to do tawaf. He finished tawaf, he drank zamzam, and then the scholars differ whether he did the Salat al-Dhuhr in Mina or he did it in Mecca. It is so difficult to finish this. Any butcher, anyone who's good in slaughtering sheep? How long it takes from you to slaughter a camel, akhi? You just tell me. How long? I'm not good in this. Anyone can tell me roughly? Slaughter a camel, akhi. Takes a lot of time. 100 camels slaughtered. A small piece of meat was cooked for him, alayhi salam. And he ate this. It's a long time, isn't it? And subhanAllah, that Allah put barakah in his time. He finished all this. I remember one day, one Hajj, one of our brothers wanted to slaughter his sheep. He spent 6 hours just to go and finish the slaughtering, come back, the traffic, etc. And he couldn't come back to Mina until Maghrib time. After Maghrib, he managed to come back to Mina. Not Dhuhr time. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to put barakah in something, you see something very strange. That's why you always ask Allah barakah in your health, in your wealth, in your children, in your everything you have. When Allah puts barakah, everything is changed. So this is what we need to do on the 10th of Dhul Hijjah, Yawm al-Nahr. Yawm al-Nahr is the day that we do most of the actions of the Hajj, which is, as we said, stoning, Ramil Jamarat, and shaving or cutting, and preferable to do shaving here. In the Umrah, when you do the Umrah and you want to come out from the state of the Ihram as a mutamatti', it's preferable to do cutting, no shaving. So you leave her for the Hajj. And this is what the companion did. But here, it's preferable to shave. It's better and more rewarded for this. So stoning, shaving, slaughtering, eating, slaughtering, then shaving, eating from your sheep if you can. And then doing tawaf and sa'i for the mutamatti'. Those four things you need to do them in order. If you can do so, if not, you can mix and there is no harm. Prophet ﷺ was asked about all these things. If someone does, for example, shaving before tawaf or does the tawaf before stoning, he said, if al wala harj, do, there is no harm to do that. There is no harm to do that. And that tawaf on that day is most important. Tawaf is tawaf al-ifada. It's a pillar as well in the Hajj. And especially for the sisters, they need to make sure to do it as soon as possible on that day. Why? Because if the sister involves or her period starts, she will be in trouble. She has to wait until she finishes the period, unless if there is no chance to wait, then we can look at her case as an individual case. We can't give general fatwa. General fatwa, person must wait until do the tawaf on the state or out of the state of the ministrating period. On the 10th of the Hijjah, on the 11th of the Hijjah and 12th and 13th, those ayam al-tashriq. Al-tashriq, do you know qadid? You know that when you dry the meat, do you dry the meat in the Eid? We still do it back home. We dry the meat, we call it qadid. The Prophet ﷺ, when a man was brought to the Prophet ﷺ, he was shaking from the Prophet ﷺ, scared that he's the Prophet. He said, calm down. I am just a man. His mother used to eat qadid, dried meat. It means just a normal person. So they know a qadid, laham, the dried meat, and we're still doing it in Eid. No, this is called qadid. You know, you dry the meat. You put some salt and you dry it, and then you can eat it later on. Anyway, they call it Ayam al-Tashriq because people those days, they don't have fridge. They just need to do qadid or they eat the meat. Otherwise, yeah, no chance. We cannot keep the meat. On the 11th and the 12th and the 13th, this is what we need to do. We just need to stone the jamarat, the first jamarat, second jamarat, and the third jamarat. On the day of Eid, you just need to do the last one, jamarat al-Aqaba, 7 times. But on the 11th, you have to do the 3 of them, 7, 7, 7. And on the 12th, you do the 3, 7, 7, 7. There is no specific dua, specific salah. You just need to shorten the salah, pray on time, make the dua, make istighfar, make tasbih, talbiyah, you finish by stoning the first stone on the day of Eid, you finish talbiyah, you just need to increase takbir and your takbir and dhikr. On the Mina, try to learn, try to attend the study circles of any durus, any lectures, make sure you attend and benefit as it's good time for you to learn and benefit. As I said to you, on the 11th, you do the three stones. And the 12th, the same, you do the three jamarat. And if you want to make ta'ajil, you can leave as long as you leave before sunsets. You leave Mina on the 12th before sunsets. If you want to stay until 13th, which is more preferable, you stay like the Prophet ﷺ, as he did so, stayed until the 13th. On the 13th, you do the three stones or the three jamarat, and then you come out from Mina, finishing everything, nothing left except tawaf al-wada'. Nothing left except tawaf al-wada', which is a normal tawaf, 7 times with the 2 rak'ah, no uncovering right shoulder, no ramal. You do it before leaving Mecca. You do it before leaving Mecca. When you are planning to leave Mecca, you might, before it was easy, you leave Mecca, then you get your camel and bismillah leave. Now it's difficult, the coaches, waiting, paperwork, etc. So when your group leader tell you to do it in that time, do it in that time and go and relax in your accommodation or wait until the coaches come and take you to Medina or Jeddah or wherever. And by doing this, you come out from the state, you finish your Hajj, and al-Hajj al-Mabroor ليس له جزاء إلى الجنة. The acceptable Hajj, there is no reward for the acceptable Hajj except the Jannah. How do you know that your Hajj is Mabroor? How do you know your Hajj is Mabroor? Can someone answer? Yeah, you try, أخي. As I said to you, no punishment, no reward. And no one say anything about you. I'll guarantee this for you. How do you know that your Hajj is Mabroor? Jazakallah khair. Sheikh Abdul Bas say one of the signs you will change after Hajj. Because فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى. When you do good, Allah will make it easy for you to become better than before. One of the signs of Hajj Mabroor, you will be changed to become better. You will not become an angel. You're still a human being. You still commit mistakes, but not like before. You're better than before. Start thinking about eating haram. Avoid this. Start thinking about the salah. Thinking about Jannah. Think about hereafter. Think about being good person. So this is number one. Also, one of the signs of Hajj Mabroor, you do Hajj according to the Quran and the Sunnah. Some people in Arafat steal and eat the food of other people and jumping in the tent of other people, doing something haram, it's wrong. This is a bad sign. It is a bad sign. Why? Because if the day of Arafah, where you're expecting Allah to forgive you, you don't care about doing something wrong, that means you are not guided. You are not helped by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do Hajj Mabroor. So those are two important things. You do the Hajj according to your knowledge. This is the best of your knowledge. Secondly, you go back or go back to you to your country better than before. You are changing. And I've seen it by myself. I've seen it by my eyes. Some people, subhanAllah, after Hajj, they are changed. Some doctors went Hajj before. And when they came back, subhanAllah, 180% changed. They became, mashallah, very close to the masjid. They used to come no attendance. They don't come to the masjid before. After Hajj, always in the masjid, good person, giving sadaqah, worried about the hereafter, etc. So his life is changed. It's a good sign. It's a good sign. Wallahu a'lam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wa jazakum allahu khayra. Barakallahu fikum.